They assemble at night, each one having prepared as diligently as possible the time given to them before the witching hour, the hour of reckoning, the time when they begin outdoor cartoon television. Stray Casts is on the air.
$1 billion.
I got a 56 Cadillac with a bass boat on the back. I got a Charger County Bass Pro, but I ain't got you.
I said I ain't got you.
Hey, we're live.
Oh, we're live?
Yeah.
Oh, nice. Hey, you know what we do have? We got a heck of a show worked up for you tonight. I'm Pat Renwick. This is Stray Cast Outdoor Cartoon Television. This is the glorified outdoor version of a bass fishing talk show. And we're here live right now in front of a studio audience, a huge studio audience. Look at them. It's the Red Bull I could do without, but it's all happening. Hey.
Hey, that's a conflicting sponsor.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Yeah. Because it's vitamin water.
Today's show is brought to you by vitamin water.
Yes.
See, we were told if we put out like a bunch of sponsor names all the time that someone will sponsor this biggest, littlest, least known show about on bass fishing on the web. So that's what we're doing.
We're working on it.
It's advice. Who told us that? Kumar?
No, who told us that, JP?
I like the orange vitamin water.
Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, sitting over here to my left, this dude right
it's delicious.
Here, this guy right here, this is JP High.
Hi, I'm JP High.
Say hello to Hi, JP. Hello, Kitty. Hey. This is JP Kitty right there. That's JP Kitty.
What's up, guys?
this dude right here with the kick-ass beard and the cool hat.
That's a cool hat.
He's our
got little, for a dollar from
he's
the gas
our little
station.
Bass buzzing lumberjack over here.
It's cold outside.
This guy, Ryan, they call him the Popcorn Whitaker. Yes.
Thank you. Hi. He calls me the popcorn. No one else has ever called me that.
No one else has ever.
But now they're calling me that.
That's what happens. You never gave me a nickname, Ryan.
Now I'm working on it.
I need a nickname.
It's coming. I mean, Thor's played out. So
yeah, they used to call.
We're
gonna
come up with something new.
When I was more stealth.
Yeah.
Before something. Yes.
That's now right. That you're less stealth.
Hey, you know who else is here in the audience tonight? Jen Berg is here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
She stole my shirt.
Jen Berg.
I stole her shirt.
Jen Berg just flipped me off.
Yeah, well.
Yeah. You didn't even see that live on the air. Hey, you know what? We got a huge show.
She's a lady.
She's got a vitamin water.
She does. She's actually drinking a vitamin water.
XXX.
Wow. This is good stuff.
Yeah.
It's boysenberry.
No. Acai blueberry pomegranate.
You don't even know how to say that.
I just said it.
Hey, we have the Arkansas Shuffle tonight. We're bringing in some Arkansas boys tonight. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Coming up first off. Old J.O., old shooter, he's the shooter, James Overstreet coming on.
Yeah.
Yeah, we all know J.O. That's the shooter right there.
Boom. McGavin.
Kapow. Bam. After that, we have old McStick.
McStick.
McStick, yeah. Coming on. Mike McClelland, Bassmaster Elite Series Touring Pro, coming on the show. Hey, you know what? It's Wednesday night. I'm always hyped up on Wednesday nights. I don't know why, guys.
Yeah.
But you know what? Pretty cool.
I think it's
gig.
The Red Bull.
Yeah, it's definitely the Red Bull.
With vitamin water as a mixer.
Yes.
And Mountain Dew.
Mountain Dew. Right. Exactly.
All the uppers.
It's just the fact that, and Dexatrim.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, whatever that is. Hey, and the fact that we get to talk to the nation's leading bass fishing professionals and personalities every Wednesday night here on StrayCast.net, on our YouTube channel, StrayCast Outdoor Cartoon Television, and now the
iTunes.
iTunes. Hey, keep it locked. We'll be right back with some bass fishing madness and James Overstreet when we return. Don't go nowhere. Stick around. We're going to have a fun time.
We now come to the heart of the matter of the direction of change. It's an idea of great significance and beauty.
Slayer Reel Tuning is Chicagoland's number one reel tuning expert. Whether you need your reel tuned up, souped up, or basic maintenance, Ben Botcher, the Reel Slayer from SlayerReelTuning.com, has your reel needs covered. Ben is the official reel tuner of Stray Casts, and he can customize your reel to your exact specifications, like new ball bearings, drag washers, clean reels, and the latest and greatest handles. When it comes to reels, go to the best and contact Ben, the Reel Slayer, and get your reel tuned to perfection and back in no time. Go to the website, SlayerReelTuning.com. That's SlayerReelTuning.com.
Welcome back, StrayCast Outdoor Cartoon Television. I'm Pat Renwick. We got the dude on. We got the dude on right now.
Dude.
We got the dude in the Santa hat.
Well,
ladies and gentlemen, we bring to you James Overstreet right now. Right here.
Yeah.
He's the next contestant on the Bass Buzz is Right.
Shooter.
What's going on, J.O.?
What's up?
It's good to see you, dude. You look phenomenal.
I thought this was a Christmas special.
This is a Christmas special,
now
actually.
It is.
You see Yukon Cornelius? He's a young Kris Kringle right here. This is Ryan Popcorn Whitaker.
What's up?
Yeah, that's...
Hi, James.
Hey, and this is JP High. He's the dude that made the awesome lion photo of you.
Please don't hate me, James.
You're a talented guy.
you're a little less intimidating with the hat on.
Yeah, we were kind of scared of you. At first, we're you know, you're kind of an intimidator.
Now you remind me of someone.
You're kind of like the Dale Earnhardt of photographers. You know what I'm saying?
Well, they're not a hard. Well, I shouldn't say that. Okay.
James, welcome to the show, man. We're glad you came on here, and you know, you've had quite a, whether you want to look at it this way or not, to us bass fishing fans, you have had quite an illustrious career. I mean, you got to do some pretty cool stuff over the past decade or so, haven't you?
Yeah, I'd agree with that. It's pretty, it is cool. So, pretty lucky guy, man.
There's no doubt about it. Give us a little breakdown. Tell us, like, how, you know, for those that don't know, how you got into this deal and where you're at right now with it. Give us a little brief timeline. Don't get too windy on me there, James. But
no, I won't. But I'm going to try to make this quick. But honestly, I didn't get initially hired by the Bass folks to as a photographer. They hired me back when the Elite Series first started. We did a segment on the show. Jerry McInnes did a segment on the show where we had tracked fish to show what they had done before the tournament and just during the practice period.
Yeah.
Actually hired me to go catch those fish and track them.
Oh, yeah. I remember.
The first Elite Series, Steve Bowman, who's still my boss, he asked me if I'd shoot the weigh-in at the first tournament at Amistad. I shot it and shot every one of them since.
Nice. I mean, and you've been doing this. You've been at it. It's pretty neat. I mean, I'm not going to kid you. You're capturing history each time. Each time you're out there, they say every picture tells a story, don't it? You know that song by that Rod Stewart guy? Him, the guy with the gerbils. You know,
yeah,
what I'm talking about? You know what I'm talking about? Wasn't there some story about him in gerbils?
There's a gerbil story.
It's like
it's
like urban
Moving
legend.
Along.
I don't even know what we're talking about actually. But no, you do. You capture history, and if it, you know, we're seeing your work, of course, with the Bassmasters. But I'm Bass Times, Bassmaster. Most of the Elite Series professionals use your photographs in their promotional stuff. You're everywhere, dude. You're kind of like a little Wizard of Oz kind of dude because you're like behind the curtain. You know what I'm saying?
All right. No, I mean, I spend a lot of days out there, obviously, so, and have spent a lot of days over the years around the sport. And I mean, I kind of look at it as capturing history, you know, the part of it I've been involved in. I mean, Gerald Crawford before me, Sago and Gary Tramontina now. I mean, they are, I mean, I guess you're fortunate to have a deal where, you know, your work will live for a while. So it's kind of how I choose to look at it. That's my responsibility to go out there and keep that going.
Thanks for being responsible. We appreciate that.
Hey, I gotta
you know.
I gotta rewind real quick here. James, back to that tracking of the fish thing. That was like the coolest thing on the show. I loved it. And talk about an awesome job. You got hired to go catch fish and tag them. That's pretty cool. But why did they stop doing that? I loved watching that. It was so cool when you'd see a fish on the screen and they're like, Gary Klein is 10 feet from this fish right now. And then did anyone ever even catch one? I don't even remember.
Yeah, actually, John Cruz caught a fish that we were tracking on Sam Rayburn, of all places.
Okay.
So you consider Sam Rayburn's, what, 106,000 acres or whatever, 60 miles long, and he catches one of the fish that we've got a tracking device in. That's, think of the odds. I mean, think how many bass are in Sam Rayburn.
Yeah.
So,
wow.
But this fish was on a bed, and when I would go by and check him every morning, I'd go out and find the fish. That's how I start my day. I could see this fish spawning on a bed in about a foot of water. I mean, you could see him from like 50 feet away, and I really was afraid that some local guy would catch that fish. But no, John went in there and actually caught one, I think the second year that – no, I guess that was the second tournament that we ever tracked fish, which would have been Sam Rayburn.
And why did that go away? Why did you guys stop doing that?
I really can't go into a whole lot about it, but Bass was owned by a different group then, and there was some
Peter.
Legal deals going on about that. So I'm not privy to all that, but I know enough about it to know that it went away for a reason.
we'll keep it right there.
Politics.
Yes, the politics of Peter. Bassin. There's no doubt.
He's privy to politics.
It's true. Yeah. It's true. Hey, when you get out there and you're, you know, here's a day that you have planned out for shooting on the Elite Series. How do you plan that out? Like, what do? You just get and go?
Usually the first 2 days, if you'll notice in the galleries, what you'll see is we're trying to find as many different guys as we can. You obviously don't know who the leaders are going to be. So you know, you just really, you're kind of scouting the lake to find out where guys are. You're trying to get as many of them in the photo gallery as you can get. You're trying to get a few fish catches if you can, but the way I look at it is I'm kind of trying to, we're trying to tell the story of that first day, then the second day, and then on, you know, what the lake looks like, how it's setting up, what kind of things they're fishing, you know, what are they kind of keying in on. And then the third or fourth days, we start kind of locking down on some leaders, and we'll have editorial meetings or go to dinner the night before and say, okay, you know, we got this guy in contention, you know, and then we'll kind of decide who's going to be on who from there.
And I think it helps that you're an avid fisherman yourself, James. I mean, you kind of, you're able to, so you're not just some lay person out there. You're actually a bass fishing photographer. So it gives you a little know-how to figure out what the heck these guys are going to do, you know?
Well, you know, now we have so much technology that at one point it was just kind of hard to just, you had to find people on lakes that some of them huge bodies of water you never been on. But I think it probably maybe helps me, you know, some on the, as far as being able to be in the right place on a guy, you know, or anticipate maybe a little bit when he pulls up on a certain piece of cover or whatever that might be to, you know, where I can have my boat in the right place to where I get a good sequence of a fish catch or whatever that might be. I think just from being a fisherman, you know, you say, hey, man, that point coming up here is going to be a key deal. Probably, I probably need to be over here.
Start so, focusing and clicking, right? That's what you're doing.
It's all about boat position, man, just there, like fishing.
There it is. Hey, speaking of boats and boat position, I was texting with Zone earlier today, and he knew you were coming on the show. So he told me to ask you about that Triton you've been running around in for oh so long that's beat up, kind of like our buddy's Millennium Falcon over here. He said that thing is just flat out beat, but it goes with you everywhere. Tell us about your boat, dude.
Boat's awesome, man. I mean, yeah, I mean, maybe I could work around and get a new boat or whatever, but I picked that boat up at the plant, the Triton plant, after the second Elite Series tournament, after it started. So this boat's like an 05, and still got the same motor on it. Still, you know, I mean, it does have, hey, we got new carpet like last year, though. It looks
good. Oh,
nice.
Good. Excellent.
Yeah, got new electronics. So, but you know, man, that boat's like a comfortable old couch to me. I mean, I don't really need a new boat. I mean, because we've been through a lot of rough rides together, and I trust that boat, and I still use it. So.
It's like Han Solo in the Millennium Falcon, right?
You got to dance with who brung you.
Yeah. So we just keep pulling it down the road, man. There's no telling how many of my Tritons should do something with that boat. I mean, there can't be a boat on the road because people don't have as much time to pull a boat around like some of us do. That has that many road miles on it. I mean, I just don't know how there could be. I mean, there can't be many if there's one. So,
I heard they're going to put it in the Smithsonian one day. I heard that's the goal.
Maybe next year.
Maybe next year, along with Babe Ruth's bats or something.
Then we may think. I don't know. I have no idea.
I bet you've been through a lot of trailer hubs on that boat.
You know, I don't know that the motor's ever been blown on that thing. It's got a mercury on it. It's I think it's had three lower units, but man, other than that, and I've never, believe it or not, and you know, when I first started, I never been on a lot of these lakes, obviously. I mean, we go all over the country, right? So I've never hit anything with that boat, you know. I mean, like, wow. I've been lucky. I hadn't like slammed into a underwater rock levee, like, I mean, you know, people tear a lot of stuff up out there, man. And I've been lucky. I hadn't done that so far, knock on wood. But I'm not saying it may happen five times next year, but so far I hadn't.
And you know what it is? Run. It's raw talent, because anybody that can drive a bass boat and operate a camera at the same time, like you do, like going 70 miles an hour in your 13-year-old Triton, dude, that's talent. Yeah. Pure but, talent right there. Raw.
You know, it's not so much talent, because I'm going to tell you the main reason that I pull that boat so many places is because generally I don't like boat drivers. don't like other people driving me around in a boat, I guess is what I'm trying to say.
Okay.
Because they tend to beat the hell out of you, for one thing, and that's not something that we have to have the talk, and the talk is always uncomfortable.
But you got to pull that intimidator on them, you know? You got to pull that J-O intimidation, dude.
Well, the first crash, it's on. I mean, there's going to be some of that going on.
Hey, what do you got going there in the background? What is all that?
Got some eggnog back there?
What is that?
Yeah, that's my Christmas tree, bro.
Well, I see that. Look, you're
talking about Grinch.
Oh, Tannenbaum. Oh, that's the Grinch.
The full-size Grinch, cuz.
Wow. You ever put him in the boat with you?
No, he only... Actually, we put him in the house for my grandkids, and I've got him unplugged right now because he's like has a motion detector, and when you walk past him, he'll start singing that Grinch song. You know, like,
how's it go? I don't know. Sing it for me.
And I can't sing.
Come
it.
On.
I don't know, really. I have it mentally blocked out because my grandkids just kept running back and forth singing, you know? And, dude, you'll want to stab the Grinch in the neck.
It's like that bit. It's
there we go. There's that intimidation coming back.
There's the lion coming out.
We unleash the lion.
I was going to say, you're losing it. You're losing it with this full-size Grinch, and then you stab it in the neck. All right.
Did you ever punch one of those big mouth Billy Basses that people had on the wall for years, you know, that would sing Take Me to the River?
No, but I set one on fire one time.
God bless you, sir. God bless you.
So you had it coming.
You've been fishing, dude. I saw you on the book face doing a little crappie fishing, and you were chasing Pokemans or something. What were you up to, dude?
Oh, yeah, my little video I did.
Yeah,
I don't know how they do that live stuff. I need to learn how to do the live. You know, they have the live where you can go live now, but I'm always scared of live things like that because, you know.
You're live right now.
Yeah, you're actually live right now. And if you need any help, just call up the Ginger Ninja, who you talked to earlier on the Skype. He'd be happy to help you out.
He's like the tech guy, the IT guru I need to talk to?
Yeah, yes. He's the dude. He's the one that made the awesome picture of McClelland and I went golfing. You remember that?
Yeah, McClelland was golfing with it looked like a hockey stick.
Yeah, he was Happy Gilmore, and you were Shooter McGavin. See, because your name's Shooter, and I was just that crazy caddy with the goofy.
You were
hair.
The homeless guy.
I was the homeless caddy. Yeah, with a. Never mind, I can't
it
say
it. The guy that beat up Adam Sandler. Oh, that was
Bob Barker.
Yeah, The Price is Wrong. The price is wrong, James Overstreet. The price is wrong. Hey, we're right up against a break. We got to pay a bill, dude. You wanna stick around? We'll come back and we'll have a little more fun. What do you say?
I'm in. Let's do it.
I got some things worked up for you, dude.
I'm sure.
Hey, keep it locked right here. Stray Cast Outdoor Cartoon Television. I am Pat Renwick. More James Overstreet when we get back. PH Custom Lures by Phil Hunter, quickly becoming the most sought-after custom balsa baits in the industry, from the Little Hunter to the Squeaky Pea. These baits are pure quality, handcrafted, hand-carved, and hand-painted. But most importantly, they flat-out catch fish. PH Custom Lures has a bait for any situation in a magnitude of colors. Check out the Old School, Straighter, and PH Custom series at phcustomlures.com. That's phcustomlures.com. Welcome back. Straight Cast Outdoor Cartoon Television. I'm Pat Renwick. This guy right here is JP High.
Oh.
He loves cats.
Yeah.
This guy right here, this is the popcorn, Ryan Popcorn Whitaker, Yukon Cornelius.
And I love vitamin water.
He loves vitamin water. We're working on sponsorship right now. Mountain Dew. Triton Boats. Whatever boat.
Yeah, hey, Red Bull.
And on the Skype machine, coming at us from Arkansas, where there's a big storm brewing, we bring you back James Overstreet right here. Yeah, buddy. Hey, James, I like to play games, dude.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm kind of like the Bugs Bunny of Bassin talk show hosts, you know?
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying?
And, I know.
Let's play a little. I'm gonna go right now into my best talk show guy persona, and we're gonna play a little word association game. Okay, so I'm gonna throw some words at you, and then I need you to just tell me the first thing that comes to your mind and explain it a little bit.
Okay, dude, I suck at this, but go.
No, you got to be. You're a photographer. You have to always think. You have to be on your feet and on top of things at all times. You understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
Okay, excellent, excellent. can I have a little talk show guy music, please? I'm Pat Redwick with James Overstreet right now. This is Word Association with J.O. James, mushmelon. Mushmelon.
Big waterhead.
A big waterhead? That is a mushmelon.
This is getting weird, wild, and wacky.
Yes, it is. It's crazy and wild right now with James Overstreet on the Stray Cash Show. Secret weapon. Secret weapon.
That's the A-rig.
The A-rig is the secret weapon. Why is the A-rig the secret weapon?
Well, it's not anymore, but it was.
Cats out of the bag. You heard it here first on Straight Cast. James Overstreet, let it out. Secret weapon, A-rig. Blowhard. Blowhard.
Oh, man, I could get in trouble on this.
Please do. Please do.
I can't do
it. Yes, you can do it. You can do this.
I can't dirt my bud like that.
You can do it. Blowhard.
Man, I know Egg a knowledge. Lot of people that fit that.
Okay, we'll pick one. This is not insulting in any way.
Oh, my wife's saying it's me.
You're picking. Okay, we'll let you out
the
of
the wild
that.
Card.
That was the wild card. We're letting you out of that one. Timber doodler. Timber doodler.
Is that like crappie fishing?
Well, I'll give you that. I'll give you that. That's
crappie fishing. Okay.
Okay. You're going for the old sockeye. Yeah, you know what I'm saying? The old sockeye slam right there. A timber doodler was an original flipper too. You know. Like D. Thomas might have been a timber doodler. You know what I'm saying? But he was a tule dipper.
The 10-foot rod's coming now. I mean, bass approved. Did you hear that? Did you hear?
Yep.
I sure did.
You could do some doodling with that.
There's going to be some timber doodling and some tule dipping and all kinds of stuff going on. But you know what? To me, I don't even think it makes a difference, honestly. I mean, it'll be all right for certain techniques, but whatever. Is it gonna win derbies? I don't know. What do you think?
I don't know. I'm going to try one. I just want to hit one with a 10-foot flipping stick.
That would be awesome, right? That would be amazing. Do you remember back in the FLW days, there was a little string of events on the Mississippi River. I believe it was 1999 and 2000. Are you speaking my language? Do you remember this?
I'm not FLW guy, but I think I know where you're going
okay,
with
this. Okay, well, in fact, they were some of the. That's when Jerry and Tommy were doing the commentary for FLW back then.
And they were making those long runs and that.
Yep, you know the Derby. Now, Gary Klein won it back-to-back in 99 and 2000. And in 99, Gary Klein was actually flipping with a 10-foot flip stick in those willow trees. And I don't even know if you remember that or not. Then he went to the 8-footer after that. But 10. Right.
How far you think Van Damme would throw a crankbait with a 10-foot crank rod?
That's what I was saying. Probably that 10XD with a 10-foot crank rod? Yeah.
Probably he could throw it from Kalamazoo to Kankakee.
He's going to need one of them big mag spools.
There's no doubt about it. But this is bass fishing history right there. I just taught you something, James Overstreet.
Man, I appreciate
Don't
that.
Don't say I never taught you a thing, okay? Here we are. God of Thunder. God of Thunder. You're right. You're not very good at this.
No, I told you, man. I don't know, dude. I don't know nothing about it.
God of Thunder. Okay. Pick a professional bass fisherman that you would call the God of Thunder.
I'd probably be Hackney.
Hackney, yes.
I mean, that's the first thing I thought of when you said that, you know, it had to be a bass, but it's probably being Hackney just from the hook sets.
Yes, that's right. That's right. And speaking of hook sets, dude, when you were on Zona's show, that was some of the most impressive hook sets I've ever seen in my life.
Yeah, there were some big fish, man. They made you kind of, I mean, you wanted to hit them hard. I mean, dude, we were on such big fish in that one stretch there that I thought, there's a lot of bone you got to go through there on some of those big ones, so. I had to put it to him pretty good.
And you did. I'm not going to kid you. My entire living room shook when you set the hook.
I amped up because I just lost close to a 10-pounder at the boat that we didn't have on the show. Ooh. So that was on like the next cast. And they were piled in there. That's where Zona caught. We had caught a 10-2 and a 9-6 in like 5 minutes off this one rock pile. So that was a cast right after I had like one close to 10 come off at the boat. So you're a little jacked up when that's going on. So.
It was bass magic. There's no doubt about it. You were like David Blaine pulling 10 pounders out of the air. It was amazing.
Hey, man, that was crazy.
Okay, last one. I'm going to stump you again.
You probably will.
Land shark.
It's good beer, man.
Is that a beer? Land shark.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Absolutely, it's owned by Jimmy Buffett, man. You got to check it out.
Oh, really? The old margarita stepped on the flip-flop, busted my pop-top guy.
That's it.
Yes, I know the Buffett. That's right. Did you ever go to Margaritaville before?
Yes, I have.
Have you? I've been there, too, actually. It's very touristy. Very touristy.
It's a little too touristy.
Yeah, I'd rather go to some of the out-of-the-way places like that bowl restaurant. Whatever that is out there in the Keys.
That bowl restaurant.
Yeah, that one bowl with the big bull horns on it. You know what I'm saying? Hey, let's get back. Okay.
Texas Roadhouse?
I'm on a 360s. All right? You ready for the loop-de-loop? Let's get back. Tell me about the most epic moment that you feel that you have ever filmed in your career as a photographer. It doesn't have to be bass fishing. It could be anything.
I think probably the classics are, you know, we have a classic and I'm on a guy that eventually wins one. You know, there's a few photographs you take during those that, you know, I can think of a couple of times that I knew I had saw a guy win the classic, you know, that I'd just taken pictures of a fish that he knew he had it won, and you know, this guy's gonna win. At the end of the day, he's gonna win the classic.
And you just know it's that feeling.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of times I think they know. It's kind of strange out there, even though you don't. I mean, we talk to each other. We kind of know what's going on with other guys. We can follow bass track and that. But I think these guys have a sense that they know the weight they got to have, and when they get there. You know, they have that one key fish in the day that'll cull their weight to a point to where they know I've done enough here, you know. And I've got, you know, some of those I know for sure with Van Dam and Skeet Reese when they won their classics, for instance, Chris Lane. When I was with those guys, there were key fish on the last days. And those photos I took of those fish catches, I knew or felt pretty sure that this guy's just won the Bassmaster Classic, right? You know, it's right there in front of you. That's it. He's going to win.
Nice. And that's good. It's good that you have that sixth sense. We had your buddy Jay Kumar on last week, and Kumar was, I don't know what was wrong with him that day, but he was okay though.
Was Kumar a little low energy on you?
Yeah, I don't know what happened.
It was too late.
Yeah,
past his bedtime.
He was tie-tie. He needed
because he works on that Bass Blaster 24, so he's probably been grinding on Bass Blaster.
You know he has, and it's paying off because that's the best thing going in bass fishing info right now, isn't it?
I told him we need it every day. He needs to do Bass Blaster. We need an email, Bass Blaster email every day.
That's right. That's exactly right.
Hey, James Overstreet. Hey. Have you ever said this to anyone in your lifetime, son? Don't make me start talking with my hands. Have you ever said that?
Yeah, gotcha. Okay.
You know, no, but I think I might.
Could you say that for us one time?
Son, don't let me start talking on my hands.
It's perfect. Perfect.
I will behave the rest of the evening.
It's perfect.
I promise you. After that. Hey, ask me some questions. Go ahead. Ask me a question. Go ahead.
You guys fish, right?
Yeah.
Absolutely, we fish. Why would you think we don't fish?
No, but I mean, I have people ask me if I fish, you know, and I'm like, really? I mean, there's photographers and people that, I guess, that don't fish in our world. I mean, some of them don't. But
are you stereotyping us right now?
No, I'm just, where do you fish at St. Clair, for instance? Where do you fish up there where you live?
Michigan?
Yeah, these guys are Lake Michigan nuts. They like to chase the brown fish on Lake Michigan.
Yeah.
And I like to fish the tributaries of Lake Michigan, the rivers, and get nitty gritty for those green fish.
Pat's afraid of water deeper than 3 feet.
And I'm afraid of mustard and mayonnaise.
Yes.
And werewolves. But I like to
people that smell like cabbage.
Yes, I'm afraid of carny people too. There's no doubt about that. But I like to fish the tributaries of Lake Michigan. But most of the people around here fish the big lake for the smallmouth. We do go to St. Clair. I mean, that's where the first time I met you over there was.
That's
was at St. Clair, and I mean, what a phenomenal fishery, dude.
Yeah, we're going back this year, 2017. Yeah,
we'll see you there. I'm gonna buy you a cup of coffee, dude.
Man, I'll be at the launch. All you got to do is be there with the coffee, and I'll drink it.
Yeah, it's going to be there. It's going to be there.
We'll
for
be
you.
Up in La Crosse a couple times this year, too. And that was the most impressive thing when you told me you hadn't wrecked your boat. I know you've been to La Crosse a few times. And
yeah,
it's a good place to do it.
I used the boat driver there this year. But
good idea.
There ended up being really easy. I was on Ike DeFoe the last 2 days, and he stayed in one place.
You had that going.
We had about a 3 mile run and we just sat in one place all day. So
did you shoot the chutes and take the shortcut?
Yeah, the guy I was with, he knew all the little short.
I almost crapped my pants the first time I did that.
It's like Okeechobee running through those little cane fields. It gets crazy, dude.
See, yeah. Okeechobee's a strange place to run, man. Because those guys down there, I mean, you'll run across, I mean, there's. Where I live, if you're running where grass is sticking up, you're probably about to hit something.
Right.
But down there, you may run for 2 miles through weeds all around your boat, you know, and you think, well, but that's what you have to do down there to get around.
It's crazy, too. And how about those cane trails where you're just flying through those little narrows? And
yeah, dude, those airboat trails down there are we had some guys get down to I can't remember who last time. They ran those airboat trails, and it got too shallow. And well, once you're back there, you know, there's no getting out. So they got stuck, and I don't think they stayed out there quite a while.
Those mosquitoes will get you. The mosquitoes are more dangerous than the gators in Florida, no doubt. Hey, James, if you could pick a celebrity to follow for the day, and not necessarily a bass fishing celebrity, you get to do that. But I'm talking about a celebrity. And you could follow them for the day and take their pictures. Who would it be?
So it doesn't have to be a fishing person or whatever. It could be anybody. They could be doing whatever it is they do or
yeah. Anything. Yeah, absolutely. You create it, dude.
Just has to be a person.
You could pick me.
I could.
Yeah.
Or not.
I'm JP Kitty.
That's the kitty cat. He likes cats.
There's that.
Yeah. He ain't picking me now.
Pick a celebrity. Come on. Who would you pick? Who would you film?
I don't know who it would be, but I know the one thing that I would like to shoot of all things that are out. If I could do how about I say there's this event. I would like to go do the Iditarod sled dog race in Alaska.
Wow. That's
my biggest deal I'd like to go do.
That would be cool, man.
I bet you could do that.
So I don't know who the guy is in that deal. There's Jeff King, I think is the guy's name. It's one that thinks I'd like to follow that guy around for his entire race.
I'm gonna have Andy Ellenberger, the Ginger Ninja, get you in touch with the right people. He knows everybody.
I'll do it. Yeah. I'd like to do that.
We're gonna hook you up, and he's gonna hook you up on your live stuff too. You're all dialed in there. Hey, did you ever see that movie, The Omen? You know what I'm talking about?
It's kind of old, right?
Yeah. It's like that kid with the 666s on his forehead.
That's some kind of devil movie.
It's some crazy devil movie. But
I remember something. I'm not real big into watching that scary stuff, but I know which one you're talking about.
Yeah. Okay. Well, that's why I want to ask you this, because we're on this show here. We like to create scenarios, okay? And we like to let you bass fishing personalities develop the scenario, okay? Now here's what we got. You're taking pictures, of course, like you always do. I mean, what a concept here, right?
Okay. Yeah, where'd you come up with that one?
I don't know. It just hit me right now. James Overstreet's taking pictures, but it's the old-fashioned kind, okay?
Right.
It's the old-fashioned kind of pictures, and you're developing these pictures in the shop, okay? Yeah.
In the dark room.
In the dark room. That's what they call these in the photo world, the dark room.
I've done that.
You're developing them in the dark room, okay? But as you're developing these photos, you notice a strange presence that shows itself on these photos.
Yeah.
Okay? It's kind of like a paranormal thing. Okay? It's the last day of the Derby, and this strange presence, it's telling you the outcome of what's going to happen to these anglers, okay? Now, you need to pick a couple, three anglers that it's showing the outcome to, and how would you help develop that? How would you help them out of trouble that's showing in these photographs on the what do you call those? Negatives.
Negatives.
Yes. Help
me
out.
So I'm going to have to go to them and help them out of what? What is it?
You're creating that. You're going to tell me the trouble they're in and how you're going to get them out of it so they can win the Derby.
So, well, I'd have to pick Aaron, of course.
Okay. Okay, go ahead. What kind of trouble would follow Aaron?
I think it'd have to be something that maybe Zona put in his head.
Okay, keep going. You're creating. I love it. Keep going.
So that means I would have to discredit Zona to make Aaron think what Zona said was completely crazy, which that wouldn't be that hard.
Give me one more.
I could work on Aaron that way.
Okay, you could get that because you're gonna he's persuaded easily.
Well, yeah, then he wouldn't believe me. He'd just be like, bro. <You know? laughs> He's not buying it. And he doesn't care. He just wants, you know, it wouldn't matter to Aaron. He wouldn't care.
He'd just keep going and talk to cats.
Yeah. Yeah. You know.
This went horribly wrong, by the way. I totally forgot what I was going to say when I asked you the entire question, just so I can get that out there. Uh-huh. Yeah. It went terribly wrong. Hey, what's in store for... Whoa, they just took care of me right there. Boom. What's in store for James Overstreet next year? You got any special things worked up?
Other than the Iditarod?
Yeah, than the Iditarod.
No, I mean, really, I don't. Other than, you know, our schedule just came out. I'm going to sit down and take a look at... You know, I shoot most of the opens now, too. So, I'm going to go down and do a little duck hunting and fishing in Texas with Shaw Griggs being...
Nice.
T-Roy from Swamp People. And
oh, yeah, yeah. Broussard.
Yeah, Broussard, my buddy, and then Dennis TJ. We're going to go down and do a little duck hunting next week for a few days and do some fishing, maybe have a little derby, little team derby.
Yeah, buddy.
And then, but now I'm going to look at the schedule. We're going to sit down and look at the schedule before long and figure out, obviously, I'll do all the Elite Series stuff. And, I mean, our open schedule starts in January, so... Got a little more time off, and then I guess we'll crank it up down. I think Harris Chain down in Florida is our first stop on the first Southern Open, first term of the year. That'll be my first gig. And after that, they come pretty quick and often. So
right, and it's nonstop. It's definitely nonstop. Hey, before you go, give us some advice. You know, we're trying to grow this thing from a seed to a tree. You know what I'm saying? And yeah. we need advice from a wise old Santa like you.
I mean, I really think, you know, I Can Ellie Show's turned out, you know, turned into really a huge success. It's an online kind of deal like you guys are doing. And I'm believe me, I'm not saying this because I think you got the right recipe, because I went back and took a look at your YouTube channel. I mean, you got to get great guests on. And, man, you had Mr. Jerry on last week.
Yeah, yeah.
You had Kevin, you know, was on. I think you just I think a lot of people are interested in the kind of people you've had on your show. And you just then keep hammering social media, man. I mean, get everybody directed towards your stuff. And I think it just happens, you know. I mean, you got a good product, and I think it's going to do good.
Nice. James, thank you so much for your support and coming on this show. And everybody, you follow James Overstreet on the book face, on the Instagram, on the Twitter. He's all over the place.
In the Bassmaster.
In the Bassmaster, on the Bass Times, the Bears. Right here, James Overstreet, thank you so much. We'd love to have you on again sometime, dude.
Thank you, man. I enjoyed it.
Awesome. And happy holidays to you.
Same to you.
There he is right there. Hey, I'm Pat Renwick, Stray Cast Outdoor Cartoon Television. Don't go nowhere. When we get back, Mike McClelland, another Arkansas, coming at you.
I'm John DeMay with Them Jigs. Today, I'd like to share with you a little bit about a couple products that we have in our lineup that we're really excited about. The first product I'd like to talk to you about today is the Joe Football Head Jig. Right out of the package, you'll notice that our football head jig is different than most on the market. What makes our jigs different is the quality of components. Let's start with the hook. These hooks are custom made for us in Japan. 90 degree bend, black nickel hooks, razor sharp, JDM quality. All of our Joe football head jigs have living rubber skirts. They're hand tied with copper wire to ensure that they stay affixed, and it also helps them to flare while they're in the water. We powder paint and heat cure each jig to ensure that the paint stays on your jig even when you're fishing rock. Another feature that separates our jig from other jigs on the market is the screw lock keeper. The screw lock keeper does a couple things for you. Not only does it keep your bait affixed, it'll save you money on soft plastics that pull off of standard barb keepers. The second product I'd like to talk to you about is our hybrid flip and swim jig. We also have a custom hook in our flip and swim jig. It's a 4-aught 30 degree bend black nickel hook. It has the same durable paint, the same great keeper, and a hand-tied silicone skirt to complete it. So if you're looking for a premium product that's going to give you an edge over your competition, look us up at demjigs.com.
Welcome back to Stray Cast Outdoor Cartoon Television. It's time for the Bass Buzz segment of our show. And we're bringing you, right now, Bassmaster Elite Series champion, Mike McClelland. Welcome, Mike.
Yeah.
How you doing? You hear our live studio audience going crazy for you?
It's a lot of them.
I heard him.
It's nuts, man. Welcome to the show. It's been a while, dude. It's been a while since the Bass Buzz radio days, and it's good to see you like this.
You know, it's awesome to catch up with you anytime I get the opportunity. It's been a year since we've been Bass Buzz, so I'm definitely looking forward to tonight.
Nice. And it's good. It's good to see you, dude. Hey, I'm going to run a couple things by you here. You've been at this about 19 years, and I know you know this. I'm letting everybody else know, and this is a reaffirmation for you. You've been at this about 19 years. You won over $1 million, 29 top 10s, 7 wins, 10 classic appearances. Do you know how many pounds of fish you've caught in your BASS career? Do you know?
I really don't, but it's got to be a bunch. I've been fishing a long time.
JP, tell him, how many pounds has he caught?
6,412 pounds.
6,400. Thank you. Give me a round of applause for JP for pulling that out.
Rain Man.
Hey, Mike, if that was tuna, you'd be a rich man.
That is right. You would be a rich
man. How much is going for a pound now?
I don't know, like 3,000 bucks. You ever see those Alaskan guys?
Exactly.
Yeah, they catch the tuna and then they drink up that money in one season, then they're broke and they got to wait for 3 months to make more money.
Exactly. Right? That's how it goes when you're tuna fishing.
That's how they live. That's how they live. Hey, now, I don't know if you know this about me, but I'm a motivator to the bass fishing stars.
Yeah.
I'm a motivator. This is what I do. I'm like a cross between L. Ron Hubbard, Tony Robbins, Bill Danson, David Lee Roth. So I'm a big happy package right there.
And Joel Osteen.
Yes, and Joel Osteen. Whoever, I don't even know. Who is that?
Don't worry.
He's
about
a
it.
Minister. Come on now.
You don't know who Joel Osteen is?
I know. Never mind. I'm a motivator.
He's also Brandon Palahniuk's manager.
I am Brandon Palahniuk's manager. That is not
unofficially.
That is not true. We totally make that up all the time.
He's also Jeff Creed's psychiatrist.
Yes.
Jeff Creed's motivational speaker.
Yes. I have now officially appointed myself as your motivator. Okay?
That's good. Because I'm the one that feels like I have to be Jeff Creed's psychiatrist. I spend many, many days a year with Jeff Creek.
God, he's got lots of people doing this, apparently.
Yeah, jump on the train.
Jeez, Luis. Okay. All right, so I'm going to run a couple things by you. I want to remind you of some things, okay? And you're going to carry this all into 2017, okay?
Yeah.
Table Rock, champion. Harris Chain, champion.
Trickworm.
Clark's Hill, champion. Grand Lake, champion. Is it there? Is it up there?
It definitely is. And I mean, I don't know if you can see the background, but all four of those blue trophies are sitting right here behind me on the fireplace mantle. You got to come down here. I have to come down here every now and then just to make sure that I realize that I have won and I can still win. And it hadn't been too many years since Table Rock, so I'm ready to do it again.
I mean, and that's what I'm saying. But I find, you know, with talking to a lot of you pro bass guys, you superstars of the sport, whether you know it or not, you're a superstar, McClelland. You are, all right? You sometimes have to be reminded of that because you kind of get into the grind. You get into the everyday tournament grind. You get up, you fish. You go to sleep, you fish. You get ready, you fish. You eat a little bit, you fish. You get your tackle ready, you fish. But you have to be reminded that you are a champion. You are a true champion, and our studio audience knows that right there.
Yeah.
That's the motivator.
Hey, and
we motivated you.
And Mike, I gotta thank you quite a few years late, but that Harris Chain win, it was like a huge turning point for my, I was just started fishing a club, and then JP and I over here, actually the first tournament we fished together, shortly after I watched that tournament, you were flipping that trick worm,
uh-huh,
straight tail worm, whatever it was, and I saw some grass and some pads, just like what you were doing. I was like, give that a try. It worked like really well, and we ended up winning. And then the rest of that season, I was just flipping that little straight tail worm around the pads where everybody was frogging, and it worked all season. So thanks for that. And man, that was an awesome tournament too. You came back with like a 10-pound deficit.
Yeah.
It was one of my favorite tournaments.
Yeah, thank God Snowden fell asleep.
Thank God they came unbuttoned for him. Yeah. Bad for him, but.
You know, that was almost bittersweet. Brian and I have been friends for many years. And, you know, to see that happen after the fact, I mean, for me to win that event and to see the hurt that it did to Brian, I mean, it was one of those bittersweet wins. I mean, I'm going to take $100,000 every day that somebody's passing it out, but it was really tough. I had drawn out with Brian years and years before in Central Pro-Am tournaments, spent a lot of time with him, and just to see that slip away from him was really pretty tough for me, honestly.
No, I know it, because you guys are tight. You know, you guys are tight on tour. Hey, who's your Thunder buddy on tour? You know, like who?
You know, I mean, I've had a few of them out there. I mean, you know, Littner and I have spent a lot of time together the last couple of years. You know, Crete. I mean, there's a lot of guys that I have spent a lot of time with and I think a ton about, man.
That's the dudes you hang with.
Pretty much. That's the ones. Faircloth mixes it up with us every now and then. So we've got a tight-knit little group of guys. It's funny how you form these cliques. I mean, you know how it is. There's these certain guys that mesh together and you get along with. I mean, we're all friends out there for the most part. I mean, there's a few of them you don't necessarily want to hang with all the time. But, I mean, we're all friends. But those little groups that you really kind of get together with.
Right. Who's your arch nemesis? Who's your arch nemesis?
When it comes to arch nemesis, I'm not going to say I've got an arch nemesis, but when it comes right down to it, I don't want to be on the water anywhere near Iaconelli. I mean, he's a phenomenal fisherman. I love to hang with him. I love to go hang out with him and do bass use, but I do not want to be anywhere around him on the water. That's all there is to it.
Wow. Is it like the intimidating factor, or is he just too loud?
He's just too loud. I mean, it doesn't matter if he's on camera or not. And that's what a lot of people don't understand about Ike. I've seen him blow up in the middle of nowhere with a camera nowhere around. And that's just Ike's personality when he's on the water. And, I mean, I've run into him a time or two, and it's like, I don't want to be here whenever I get around him. There's a lot of guys I don't mind fishing around. But Ike's one, if I see him sitting somewhere I want to be, I'm probably going somewhere else.
Yeah, I was at McDonald's with him one time, and he ordered a plain quarter pounder, and they gave it to him with everything on it, and he threw it at people. It was awful.
I don't
know. Yeah. Now, off camera, he's amazing.
It was awful. Hey, you got a shoulda, woulda, coulda moment in your bass fishing career? Like something you could have done, like you should have done this, but you didn't.
You know, and I give Skeet all the credit in the world for winning the Classic at the Red River, but that was the should have, could have, would have moment for me. The Red River, the first day, I big-eyed him. I'm not going to deny it. I mean, I caught a limit in like the first hour I fished. I truly, in my mind, thought I had over 15 pounds in the live well. I have not seen another competitor in the area I'm fishing, and I'm thinking, I've got to leave here. I've got to go somewhere else. And call, I've got to save these fish. And I left my area. As soon as I got to the weigh-in and started pulling the fish out of the live well, I didn't call the rest of the day. And I realized all of a sudden, these fish aren't near as big as I thought they were this morning. The first day I was like 12 and a half pounds. You can go back and look at the records. The second day I had, I think, 17 or 18 pounds. The third day I had a little over 20 pounds. I lost the Classic by like a pound, 12 ounces, and I should have stayed on those fish the first day until I knew I had what I should have had.
And you had a better spinner bait than the one Skeet was throwing, too.
No denying that. I mean, a War Eagle spinner bait in the little finesse version, that was actually before the little finesse version was even introduced. We were playing with it at that point in time, and it was a phenomenal bait. It still is today.
What's the history of that bait? I mean, what's the how? I mean, it's the Mike McClelland signature model, but you know, like Ryan was saying, dude, we catch a lot of fish on that War Eagle. That's
it's seriously the only, I don't know, people laugh at me because it's the only spinner bait I like to throw.
It's a good dude.
I'm not blowing smoke. That thing it's insane. It's so good. Thanks for making
it. Now, when you say the only spinner bait, are you talking about War Eagle across the board?
No, I'm talking about I'm talking about the Mike McClelland War Eagle.
He can't catch him on a willow leaf.
I don't know. I can catch fish on another spinner bait.
No,
he can't. That thing is just awesome, man. The vibration is so insane. I feel like I'm reeling a lipless or something like that when I'm reeling it, and I can feel it when it gets grass on it to get it off. A lot of the other spinner baits, I can't feel it. It's got a good feel to it. And
well, I can't take all the credit for it. I mean, I'm going to tell you straight up the way it went. A few years back, and this has been a number of years back, it may have actually been the cotton picking tournament that Skeet Reese won on the Potomac River. Creek and I were traveling together, and we were both catching a few, but Creek started catching them on a little spinner bait that was called the Limit Getter. Okay. A very, very similar comparable spinnerbait to what is now the War Eagle Get 5 Quick or, you know, finesse spinnerbait. And I actually took War Eagle frames and I built a bait similar to the one that Jeff Crete was throwing and had good success. I ended up making the top 12 in that event. But that is how the bait all came together. It definitely wasn't my brainchild. I went back to War Eagle and I said, you know, Keith, you've got to build a bait like this. And they actually made the frame more compact and came out with what is now the 3/16 and 5/16 ounce War Eagle finesse spinnerbait.
It's amazing. I throw the 5/16 most of the time. Is the size I'm throwing. I think that's that to me that's the deal, that 5/16 size.
It don't matter as long as it's blue shed.
Yeah. Well, it really doesn't matter as long as it's a War Eagle skirt. I mean, the skirt's so much of a key to what the War Eagle spinnerbaits do. I mean, the way that skirt's hand-tied and the way the action, comes off the bait, it's a all-around good spinnerbait. The wire vibration, everything about that bait's just the bomb. I mean, that's all there is to it. When you say the 5/16, for most bass fishing applications, the 5/16 is the one. But, I mean, you got to understand, there's a lot of people out here wading around in creeks and throwing baits in ponds, and that little 3/16 ounce finesse spinnerbait, it'll get it done in the creeks and the ponds, I'm telling you.
Yeah, no doubt about it. Hey, who's the best spinnerbait fisherman in the galaxy? Who's the best spinnerbait fisherman in the galaxy?
Well, there's two or three that really come to mind. And Rick Klun, he hurt my feelings a little bit last year at Texoma because he basically got up there and said that nobody knew how to fish a spinnerbait anymore.
Wow.
And Rick Klun is one of the most phenomenal spinnerbait fishermen ever. Jimmy Houston, I would say, has to rank right up there among the best. And Gary Klein. Those would be the three top spinnerbait fishermen, if I was to pick right now, that there ever have been.
How would you fare in a spinnerbait derby against those three? What do you think, Mike?
Well, I think if it was one of those deals where it was only a spinnerbait that I could put in my hand, I would fare pretty well. But I have that sense of wanting to be versatile. And last year when we were at Texoma, for example, I caught a few on a spinnerbait, but I didn't think it was the winning bait. I felt a lot more comfortable flipping the bushes and the willow trees and things like that. And I missed that spinnerbait bite a little bit. But there's no denying the fact that you put a spinnerbait or give me the opportunity to put a spinnerbait in my hand, I really feel like I can fish up there among the best of them there ever have been.
Yeah, there's no doubt in my mind. You come to mind in one of the top fishermen spinnerbait-wise. On the tour, there's no doubt.
Well, I appreciate that because I know you guys and your knowledge. I mean, you got Catman sitting over here in the corner and the knowledge that this guy has about fishing. I mean, to hear that coming from y'all, that means a lot to me. It really does.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. You also love to fish the jigs too. I mean, you're a jig dude too.
There's no doubt.
Now tell us the biggest mistake that you see people making when they're fishing a jig. What's the biggest mistake? What's the big no-no that you see weekend guys doing, or maybe even pros? What are they doing?
To me, the biggest mistake that most anglers that are jig fishing today make is setting the hook too hard. And unless you're flipping extremely heavy cover, I mean heavy vegetation, matted grass, extremely thick bushes, with the fluorocarbon sun lines we have today, the braided lines we have today and the needle sharp gamakatsu hooks we have today, you don't have to jerk hard anymore. You just lean back and reel into them and they're yours. And that's the biggest mistake I see people make fishing a jig.
So don't set the hook like Overstreet. That's what
exactly.
You're saying.
Exactly. Exactly.
Don't go doing it. Don't go doing it. Hey, Mike, we're right up against a break right now. You want to hold on for a second? We'll come back and we'll have some more fun.
Absolutely. I'm here for you.
Excellent. Mike McClelland, more of him coming up on the Bass Buzz segment of Straight Cast Outdoor Cartoon Television when we return. Please stay seated.
Swim jig technique is one of the most successful ways to put fish in the boat. Time in and time out, Bravani bait swim jigs are just the right tool for the job. Beaming with quality, the Bravani swim jigs come in a myriad of colors, feature the best premium hooks and solid trailer keepers to give you, the serious bass angler, the confidence you need to accomplish your goal of putting more fish in the boat. So go to BravaniBaits.com and start climbing the ladder to swim jig success.
How did you change your body? I mean, like, just really working out?
Mm-hmm.
Could you take...
I did
martial arts a lot and full contact karate and weights. And
could anybody do that? Could you do it?
Definitely, yeah. It just takes determination, hard work, and a good instructor.
Welcome back. Bass Buzz segment. Stray Cast Outdoor Cartoon Television. I'm a cool jerk. Are you a cool jerk, Mike McClelland?
Absolutely.
You're a cool jerk bait fisherman. I do know that about you. You can throw that jerk bait, dude.
I do enjoy that as well. There's a lot of things I love to do, and I think that's sometimes what throws us off at certain times of the year. I mean, you go into certain events thinking, you know, this is the way you're going to catch them. And when it's jerkbait season, I'm going to be throwing it from daylight till dark. And you miss it sometimes. You miss the little subtle things that you need to pick up on. But as far as catching them, I don't know that there's another way I would rather catch a bass than on a Spromix stick. I mean, honest to goodness.
We were just talking about this at the break. But, I mean, you kind of have three of the best baits on the market.
You got like the best lineup.
Yeah. I mean, baits. You got the War Eagle finesse spinner bait. Yeah. We talked about that. You got that kick-ass football jig. What's that? Who makes
the
that
Jewel?
One?
You know, actually, I mean, I've been involved with them in the past. They build a phenomenal product. I can't knock the Jewel product, but I've recently, the last couple of years, I've tried to look at some different options. I'm actually throwing a little, it's just a house brand jig. It's actually still made by the same company that makes the Jewel product. My son works at a local tackle shop here. It's called a Bassex jig. And the reason I went that direction is my son hand ties a lot of stuff.
Okay.
And it gave me the opportunity to have a lot of special stuff made. It's still a great product. It's made by KG Enterprises, which is the company that makes Jewel products. So very similar product, but I just wanted to go a different route this year.
Good, because we thought it because they weren't paying you enough, so we were going to go rough them up for you, Mike.
They're good people, man. There's nothing wrong with the Jewel product.
And then the Mixed Stick, one of the best jerk
How did that get named? Were people calling you Mixed Stick?
Are you Mixed Stick? Is that what the deal is? Are you,
you know, it has come to be one of my nicknames on tour. And, you know, Crete didn't actually give me that name. Crete gave me the name Peepaw. And, I mean, it's one of those nicknames that I came by, honestly. I'm not going to deny it. But I honestly think the McStick deal came from a former manager at Spro, actually. Tim Norman was the one that came up with the McStick name, and it stuck. I mean, the bad thing about it, and a lot of people don't know this story, McDonald's has actually legally pursued Spro Bait Company over the McStick name. And the thing that's cool about it is I keep getting told by Spro I have job security because they have to change the name of the bait if they ever get rid of me.
Wow. Hey, that's all right, man. Round of applause for that. Come on, Larry. That's pro bass fishing. That's how you pro bass fish.
Right, I'd rather have McStick than McFib.
Yeah. This is the McFibber.
That's what
right
they call
here
me in Wisconsin.
Yeah.
If you don't know what a fib is, you'll have to look it up because I can't say it on the
it's
air.
It's a forked up but Illinois something.
Yeah.
Something
child
like that.
Child without a married.
Yeah. Double. But anyway, you know what? I'm gonna make a confession to you, Mike. I don't like fishing a jerkbait. It's way too much work for me. I like them when I'm catching them on it.
This coming from the guy that does nothing but wind at 100 miles an hour.
I like to throw a spinner bait and a square bill and flip. That's what I do.
But a jerk bait's too much work.
A jerk bait's a lot of work, man. What, am I doing something wrong?
There's certain times of the year, though, especially living where you live, that really jerk bait fishing shouldn't be that much work. I mean, you can throw them out there. You have to twitch them a little bit more than maybe you do when you're just winding. But, I mean, when you're chasing brown fish, you really don't have to slow a jerkbait down as much as you do down here in the South.
No. Yeah, and I think that's why, because I fish for the largemouth.
Well, and dude, when you're on them on a jerkbait, you got to twitch it like four times before you have a fish.
But I get impatient. Like, I get impatient with the jerkbait for some reason.
There's a lot of truth to that. I mean, a jerkbait is one of those baits that when the bite is that cold water, slow suspending action that the McStick does so well that you have to be patient. I mean, I can literally think of times that I've let a bait set 30, 45 seconds up to a minute waiting on a bass to eat it. So it can be a little bit trying at times. There's no doubt.
You send a text message while it's suspending.
Multitask. You know, Ryan almost caught the state record Illinois smallmouth while talking to me on the phone. He almost accidentally caught it.
Multitasking.
Yeah, you might have seen it on the Bass Blaster. He got blasted for it. He got blasted. It was amazing. Give me some jerkbait tips, man. Help me out. Give me some confidence in a jerkbait.
You know, the biggest thing about a jerkbait, it's one of those baits that you need to go out and throw at the right time of the year. A lot of people make the mistake of not throwing a jerkbait to gain confidence at the right time of the year. I mean, generally pre-spawn, when the water first starts warming up, is the most ideal time to throw a jerkbait. When you're up north like you guys, I really believe that once the ice thaws and that water temperature starts rising 2 or 3, 4 degrees, that's when those fish get on a jerkbait best. And that's the same way it is down here in the Midwest. I mean, once the lakes cool down to the coldest temperature they get to in the winter and then they start warming back up, that's when fish get on a jerkbait really good. You can still catch them when the water's cooling, but in my opinion, that warming trend is what really sets fish onto a jerkbait, and that's the times you really need to focus on it. You've got to develop a cadence. I mean, whether it's a cadence you see somebody else do or if it's your own little cadence. I mean, I typically like to wind the bait down. I twitch it a couple times. I make myself count in my head. I'll twitch it a couple times, let it set again. And it's learning how long to let that bait set. Once you figure that out, it's game on. That's all there is to it.
Now, this is a true or false question.
True or false?
True or false. Sometimes Mike McClelland throws jerk baits on monofilament as opposed to fluorocarbon.
True.
Talk to me.
The biggest thing about fluorocarbon versus monofilament is when I'm fishing extremely cold water, if I'm letting that bait set, fluorocarbon line is dense and it sinks in the water column. So if you're sitting there with slack in your line and you're letting that jerkbait set 15 or 20 seconds, that fluorocarbon line is pulling below the bait and you actually lose contact with the bait. It actually starts pulling the bait deeper. Monofilament, on the other hand, is basically neutral buoying in the water. So whatever depth you get the bait to, monofilament isn't going to sink the bait. It isn't going to float the bait. So it absolutely lets the bait work as naturally as it possibly can. And that's the real difference maker. If I'm fishing the bait fast, I'm going to throw Sunline Reaction FC. If I'm fishing the bait extremely slow, I'm going to throw Sunline Supernatural Monofilament, and that's all there is to it.
And that, folks, really? Right there is the Mike McClelland Bass Buzz Tip of the Week. Right.
And, and Mike, you would also... the line size or the line type could also be dictated by how deep you're trying to get the bait too, right?
Yes, that's absolutely true. The smaller diameter line you throw, the deeper you're going to be able to get the bait. That is the one benefit to fluorocarbon. If you were really trying to get a jerkbait to the deepest point that you could get it, fluorocarbon is going to allow you to do that because of the fact that it is dense. It's going to sink when you stop and put slack in it. So it will pull the bait deeper. The thing a lot of people don't understand about jerkbait fishing is you don't want to get to the level the fish are at. You want that jerkbait to stay above the fish because 90% of the time those fish will feed up, but they very seldomly will go down to get a bait. So the thing that you're trying to do with a jerkbait is you're trying to coax them up to get the bait. And honestly, you can get a jerkbait too deep, and that is one of the biggest mistakes I see people making with jerkbaits is they're trying to get the bait actually too deep.
That's awesome you mentioned that. JP and I were fishing a derby last weekend in 43-degree water, and we're throwing jerkbaits that are only going down about 4 feet over 20 feet of water. We're getting bit. I tried a deeper jerkbait. They wouldn't touch it. I was probably getting below the fish then.
Absolutely. I mean, that's the thing that so many people miss when it comes to jerkbait fishing is those fish are seeing a shadow above them. They're seeing an image or just, you know, something above them that makes them come up to get it. Most of the time fishing cold water, they're really not that hungry. And you're kind of trying to coax them. I use this example a lot in seminars. If I walk by you carrying a plate of smoking hot chocolate chip cookies, and I walk by really fast. Every now and then, somebody might reach out and grab one of those cookies. But if I come in front of you and I wave that cookie plate in front of you and I let you smell that aroma coming off that chocolate chip cookie, you're going to reach out there and get one. And that's basically what you're trying to do with the jerkbait in the cold water. You're trying to tempt them into getting it. And that's the reason you want to hang it up there above their head.
Feed it to them.
Yes. I feel a lot better about jerkbait fishing now.
Yeah, you can go catch him now, right?
Yeah, I mean, you were my jerkbait psychologist right there. I love it. I love it.
That really was great stuff.
Yeah. For real.
Pat, I've got the simple answer for you. Okay. I mean, we've talked spinnerbaits, we've talked jigs, we've talked jerkbaits, but if you just like to crank, what about the new rock crawler, dude? I mean, that's the bait for you.
Well, funny you bring that up, because right here on the list, right here, I got this little word right there. What's that say?
That says wiggle wart.
That says wiggle wart right there. And you come from wiggle wart country.
The land of the wiggle wart.
The land of the warts. And you can get shots and get those burned off, too. But wiggle warts, I mean, they're notorious bass catchers in cold water. And I know that you designed that rock crawler to mimic that bait, didn't you?
That's exactly what happened. And, you know, everybody knows that in 2014, when I won Table Rock, a wiggle wart had a big part to do in that tournament win. And that, fortunately, was the thing that finally got Spro to say, okay, let's build the bait you've been talking about. I actually had prototypes of the bait already done prior to that event. But after I won the Table Rock event using a wiggle wart, for probably 50% of the fish I caught, they're like, okay, let's do it. The thing about a wiggle wart, it's a phenomenal bait. It catches a ton of fish. The old wiggle warts are not the same as the new wiggle warts. There's no denying the fact that there's something different about them. And basically what I did was I took the characteristics about that bait that I always liked, and Spro allowed me to put those characteristics in this bait. We sized the bait up a little bit. I mean, I've got one right here, by the way.
Nice.
I made a little bit bigger.
Look how you did that.
We made the bait dive a little bit deeper. All the things that I wanted it to do, we were able to accomplish. And that's the thing that's so cool about working with Spro and the people I get to work with in this industry, is they truly listen to what I want to do, or what all the pros do. I mean, Cruz has done such a phenomenal job with all of his baits, and Russ Lane and Dean. I mean, we've all worked together on our projects that we work on, and we get feedback from one another from time to time. And, you know, it just really works out well to come up with a bait that really, really catches them.
And what are those characteristics that you keyed in on? I mean, a lot of guys know and a lot of them don't, but tell us the characteristics that make that rock crawler or a wiggle wart so effective.
You know, this is one of those things that a lot of guys disagree on. I know Mark Davis and I both see things differently. When I talked to Mark about what characteristics about the wiggle wart he liked the best, he liked the older wiggle warts that had the real kind of high tinny sound to them.
Okay.
They had a couple BBs in them, and when you shook them, they kind of had a lot of rattle. Where I always liked the wiggle warts that the ball was almost hung up in, and they didn't hardly make any noise. They were almost a dull sound. The biggest thing about a wiggle wart or a rock crawler, the characteristic that makes this bait so different, is the way the bait hunts. And when you talk about a bait
yes,
that hunts,
thank you.
It's all about the way the bait hunts. When it hits the bottom and deflects, a lot of baits deflect and they go a couple of inches one way or the other. The thing about these baits is when they deflect, they may crawl off 2 or 3 feet one way or the other before they right themselves. And that's what makes the rock crawler and baits like that such a good bait.
And the fat girls can't stand it. It's like being in line at an all-you-can-eat biscuit and gravy buffet.
That's exactly Boom. What I would say.
You can use that one, Mike. It's okay. I haven't trademarked that one yet.
Okay.
All right. That's all yours in the next Spro product meeting. They eat the rock crawler like a fat woman at a biscuit and gravy all-you-can-eat buffet.
All right. I'm in on that.
That's yours. Write it down. Hey, we play a little game here. You saw Overstreet, and we played a few games with Overstreet, so it's game playing time. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
Okay, cool. And this is an easy one. I'm gonna break you in here. Okay.
All right.
This is a little game we call play. I'm twisting my words up today. I don't know what
a little game
a
we
little,
play
a little
called.
Game we play called three rods on deck and one in hand, meaning you have can only fish with four sticks. Okay, four sticks. Bass has a new rule.
Four mixed sticks.
Four mixed sticks, only four rods only. So three of them on deck, one in hand. What are those combos going to be? And break it down. Rod, reel, line. Go ahead.
Four rods. The first rod be a Falcon 7-4 Signature Series rod. It's a CCB 6174. I would pair that rod with a Ella's Arachnid 6-1 gear ratio reel. I would have Sunline 4 Carbon. And that number one rod is going to have a 1/2 ounce brown round rubber Bass X jig with a Cabela's Ditch Cross trailer.
Okay. All right. There's one. There's number one.
Number two would be the very same rod, the very same reel, the very same line, probably with a ball and chain tied to it. I mean, you can't ever go anywhere at certain times of the year without a ball and chain. I mean, that's just all there is to it. And I know some of y'all don't know what I'm talking about, but I'm talking about a Carolina rig.
Yeah, no, absolutely we do. You just froze. What happened to Mike?
You're frozen.
Okay.
Am I still here?
Yeah, okay, there you go. Now we're back to normal. You're back in the McClelland man cave, thank God. Okay, keep going. You got two more combos left.
Rod number three would be a Cabela's Arachnid reel on a 6.8 McClelland Signature Series rod with probably 12 to 14 pounds Sunline FC reaction line. And on that rod, I'm going to have one of my Spro jerkbaits.
Okay, there you go. One left.
Left would be a 7.2 McClelland Signature Series Falcon rod with 16 pounds Sunline Shooter fluorocarbon, and that rod would have a War Eagle spinnerbait of some kind tied to it.
Boom. I like that that there's no spinning rod in there.
Absolutely.
I thank you very much for that.
No fair ones.
These guys could have those sissy sticks any day. there's no doubt about it. What's eating you, Popcorn?
No. I was just going to recap. We got the jig.
Got the jig.
Got the mixed stick. We got the ball and chain.
The old ball and chain.
And then the spinnerbait.
There it is. I mean, those are your confidence.
That'll cover
baits.
It all.
That's going to cover you around these whole continental United States.
Not going to be fishing much slop with that combo, though.
There's no denying I'm not going to fish much slop with that combo. That kind of leads to where my strengths fishing are.
I figured out what kind of fisherman you are.
Yeah.
By that, yeah.
That's just it.
Yeah.
Hey, you ever think about bass fishing in Cuba?
I never have. Are there bass in Cuba?
Dude, there are giant bass in Cuba. And now that one guy died, what's his name?
Fidel Castro.
Dead.
We can go there
He's
now,
gone.
Right?
He's gone. We can get stogies.
Yeah, you can go.
And we can go bass fishing in Cuba. When I was
good
a
luck
kid,
finding a boat.
We're about the same age. What are you?
Is he dead?
Yeah, is Castro dead or is he?
I don't think he's dead.
Oh, he's not?
No.
Well, he is now.
So? But,
I don't know. Look, somebody Google that.
Larry?
He's
dead.
See,
he's dead.
You didn't even know.
I don't know.
Yeah. All right. But anyway.
Oh, I saw him on TV.
Cuba has an untapped giant bass population, Mike.
Yeah?
Yeah. You got to go. Me and you should go hang out in Cuba.
How far is it from Cuba if we just put the boat in like at Key West and run there?
I say we do it, dude. It's not going to be any worse than some of those St. Clair runs, you know,
anyway. I would have to say it couldn't be any worse than Erie.
Yeah.
And now that what's his name isn't around, there's nobody dictating what you can throw.
Yeah.
You can throw whatever you want.
Yeah. We could throw a cigar, wacky rig a cigar. We could do whatever the hell we want. That's the magic of it.
As we don't have to throw A rigs, I'm in.
That's the secret weapon. It's the secret weapon. Hey, You know, seriously, if you're around in the Mike McClelland man cave sometime, Google bass fishing in Cuba. It's pretty cool.
I'll do it.
Giants. And they in the 80s, you used to be able to take bass fishing trips to Cuba, okay? Like
yeah.
They had them like they do bass fishing trips to Mexico and stuff like that. So if you're booking bass fishing trips to Cuba now, some of the tackle they have there is from like 1982. That the guy
there might be some old stuff there that we would all like to get our hands on.
Might be some old wing awards.
You know what I'm saying? Exactly, are some old Fenwick Lunker sticks or something, Skyline Graphite rods.
Some OG, you know, Big O's.
Some Bagley Balsa B3s in mint condition, you know what I mean?
I know what you're talking about there.
We're speaking the same language right there. All right, you ready to play a little word association, Mike?
Let's do it.
All right, we're gonna. In case you didn't see the show before, what we do is we throw a little something at you, and you tell me the first thing that comes to your mind and give us a brief explanation, okay?
Right.
Now, I'm gonna go talk show on you right now, okay?
Okay.
Word association with Mike McClelland. Where's my producer? He's doodling something on the... Larry, produce the hell out of this.
He's drawing a guitar.
Yeah, give me some produce music.
Okay. Give me some cues.
Yeah. This is important.
Word association with Mike McClelland. Mike... Nedrick.
I mean, it's the most phenomenal way to catch a lot of bass on Table Rock and Beaver and Bull Shoals Lake.
Whoa!
You look at that.
This guy right here, JP Kitty High.
Yeah.
Best Nedrick fisherman on the planet.
You
need to take him.
I'm the best Texas rigger in the Midwest.
Hot burrito.
It's one of my favorite foods of all time.
Really?
Yeah, absolutely. I love burritos.
What are you getting inside that burrito? What's the deal?
Oh, anything but beans. I mean, leave the beans off and I'm good to go. I mean, we're talking ground beef,
tongue?
Carne asada beef, some sour cream, lettuce, black beans, just no refried beans.
Yeah, those get nasty a little bit.
Yeah, black olives, jalapenos. I mean, heat it up, whatever you want to do.
It's called the McClelland Special.
That's right.
It's the
McClelland. Just fry those beans once.
Jigger polling.
I think that's what those guys used to do many years ago when they sculled. They would scull around and they would drop their pole into the bushes and stuff and catch crappie and brim and things like that, right?
Yeah, that you're exactly right. Jigger polling, in fact, is one of the original ways of flipping. You know, it was called doodle socking and jigger polling. And do you know what the original jigger pole lure was? What they used for bass?
I would really not have a clue there.
It was a baby bottle nipple.
A baby bottle nipple.
True story.
Come on, dude.
Not making it up.
Was that some D. Thomas stuff?
Not making it up. No, this is before D. Thomas.
Okay.
This is like Homer Circle stuff. This is way before that. So what they would do is run the line through the baby bottle nipple.
Okay.
Put a treble hook on there, on the opposite way, and they would just go find a stump. Okay. And they would take that jigger pole and just pop it around the stump. Boom, 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 boom. Real aggressive. And all of a sudden.
With the nipple floating on the surface.
Yeah, boom. You're just popping it along. And then before you know it.
That would work.
Boom. A big slubberdegullion comes out of the deep and just chomps it.
I can understand why that would work.
Chomps it. It's outlawed now. It's outlawed. It's so effective.
It ought to be.
It's so. What if? What if?
What if?
What if?
I'm 3 for 3, right?
Yeah. You're nailing it, dude. What if? Okay. You're doing way better than Overstreet.
Okay.
What if?
All right. I lost you.
Yeah.
What if?
Well, give me a scenario. What if blank blank?
Then see, you stumped me with what if.
That was supposed to.
I guess I would have to say, what if I won the Bassmaster Classic or Angler of the Year this year?
That would be awesome. Yes. Be awesome. Yes. That's what we're looking for. 65-pound braid.
Sunline 65-pound braid is the most unbelievable braid to flip, throw a frog, a buzz bait. A walking bait, it's the bomb.
And it actually puts that Stratus back on the trailer for you at the end of the day.
Yeah, it would do that too.
You see how I threw a sponsor plug in there for you? You like how I did that?
I like that.
That's how I roll there. 100% of the time. 100% of the time.
100% of the time, I believe every cast I make, I have the opportunity to catch a bass.
That is the power of positive thinking. See, it brings us back to the beginning of the show. So it's working, right? We're rubbing off.
It's working.
Yeah, you're gonna wreck him next year, dude.
Absolutely.
I mean, he's all over this. he's all over this. Hey, do you ever think bass fishing will go mainstream? I mean, it's bigger now than it ever has been. But do you think that it'll be as big as pro golf or NASCAR or even the top threes, baseball, basketball, football?
Our kids gonna get in trouble for bringing their flipsticks to school.
Yeah.
You know, I really think there are things happening within this industry right now that if bass fishing is ever going to go mainstream, it has the opportunity to do it in the next couple of years. I mean, Major League Fishing has done incredible things for this sport when it comes to the non-fishermen finally getting involved in our sport. I mean, when you can actually watch a program and root for a guy and not know whether he won or not, to me, that is what brings the average everyday person to the sport of bass fishing. And when we finally get the opportunity to be aired on some kind of a mainstream network, I think bass fishing has a chance. Can it ever be as big as NASCAR or golf has been or maybe once was? Maybe not, but I definitely think mainstream or bass fishing can become mainstream in this world.
I mean, I sure hope so. I sure hope so for all of our sakes. That it is. But do you think that there will be a time when the majority of people will say, oh, cool, Major League Fishing's on CBS this Saturday? Or will they be
if
like...
If that comes, that is going to be one awesome thing that I mean, that's one of those deals that we've all dreamed of. And if that ever happens, that is going to be one of the most incredible things that has ever hit bass fishing and bringing it to be a part of the mainstream world.
How you liking the MLF, Mike?
MLF is the most intense competition I've ever been involved in my life. I mean, when you look back at I played a lot of sports in school. I'm not going to claim I was great at any of them. But, I mean, I played baseball all the way through my senior year of high school, played on state championship teams. The adrenaline rush that you get in that game time moment is there in Major League Fishing. When we go out and fish a normal bass fishing tournament, you're fishing against the fish and yourself. When you go to a Major League Fishing event, you're fishing against the scoreboard and what everybody else is doing, and you know it in real time. And that's what truly has changed the face of fishing, in my opinion, to a lot of people. When you compete in that Major League Fishing format, it's the most intense thing you've ever done. I run a marathon at the end of a Major League Fishing day.
Nice. Now, give us a little insight into the upcoming season. I know you guys aren't supposed to talk about it much, but give JP, what do you say? Give us some dirt.
Oh, throw the Ned rig.
What's coming up? I mean, the season starts soon, right? It starts in January.
Every fish counts.
It definitely does. I mean, and you know as well as I do, I mean, we're all bound by non-confidentiality agreements, things that we can't talk about. It's going to be an exciting season. There's a lot of cool announcements that are going to be made. There's a lot of crazy stuff that goes on this year. I think we've had some of the best fish catch opportunities that we've had in a few years. I mean, I think everybody knows where the events were actually held at this point. But when you see how the competition goes down, it's going to be pretty cool. And when you see the whole end of the year finale, it's going to be a pretty awesome experience.
And I got to tell you, what one of the things that MLF has over BASS or FLW is babes. You got babes. I mean, you got a couple hotties on the MLF.
I'm not going to deny that. We do have two very, very attractive women that are part of the crew at MLF. And that brings a little added taste to the events. I mean, if you look at ESPN today and all the sports talk shows, you've got to have those hot, attractive women on those shows. And Major League Fishing realized that. And here they are.
I mean, nothing against Sanders and Zona, but I'd rather look at Shelly Sanders. And the new girl you got.
Yeah, I mean, you can't even compare Tommy Sanders and Mark Zona to what Major League Fishing has.
Yeah, the only thing, you got Shelly Sanders and Tommy Sanders, the only thing in common there is the name.
Yeah, I mean, and I think they kind of weigh each other like this, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Tommy and I are good friends. Tommy, if you're watching, buddy, I'm sorry.
No, Tommy's on the show before, too. I told him the same thing. I told Jerry the same thing when he was on a couple of weeks ago. BASS elites need cheerleaders. We need cheerleaders, damn it.
Yeah, and, you know, we all need cheerleaders. And, I mean, that's the reason we've got, you know, our hot wives that follow us around on circuit today. I mean, you know, you just look at the guys that are successful right now and all the hot women we got traveling around with us.
Yeah, it's nice the real save, Mike. It's the real yeah, he did good there, didn't he? It's the real lives of Bassin wives. It's a reality series.
It is.
The real lives of Bassin wives. Guys, write that down. Write it down because I just thought of it right here.
Hey,
write that down.
Hey, Mike McClelland, I remember reading somewhere that your son is fishing the opens.
He is. And it's been one of those years that I hated he didn't have a little more success than he did, but I truly wanted him to see the real world. I mean, you know, it's easy for him to sit here at home, and when I have a bad event, he like rags on me. Dad, why didn't you do this? Dad, why didn't you do that? And I wanted him to have success this year, and he did draw one check. He was competitive in a couple of other events, but to see him get out there on his own, and honest to goodness, I mean, when I finally quit helping him, he became a better fisherman. What he's accomplished the last 2 years here at home has been on himself. I mean, he's done it the way Justin McClelland does it, not the way I would have done it. And to see how he looks at the lakes that we go to, it's totally different than the way I look at him. And it's really been cool to watch him evolve as a fisherman. And I truly believe if he gets the right opportunities, if he gets the right breaks, he's going to be better than I ever thought I was. I mean, that's all there is to it.
Nice.
So he's not giving up. He's going to keep going.
He's going to fish him again. He's actually got his entry in right now for the opens next year. Chris, Jerry, whoever might be watching, give him a little favor. Make sure he gets in. And, we've got three awesome lakes. Well, all three of them I'm looking forward to. I mean, when you look at the Central Open schedule, Grand Lake, Table Rock, and the Sabine River, you know, and I'm knocking on my wood table right now because
who is it?
I've been top 12s the last two or three years we've been at any of those events. So, I mean, I feel like I can win at any of them. My son, he can win at Grand. He can win at Table Rock. And if he gets fortunate, he has a chance to win at the Sabine, too. So,
yeah, you were close.
Kind of breaks he has to have.
You were close at Sabine, weren't you?
Absolutely. I mean, second place. I mean, I made the top 12 there 2 years in a row after running 127 miles one way to catch a fish.
Nuts. Wow. Nuts. Absolutely nuts.
Wow.
One lake. What is your one dream lake? When this is all said and done, you've won your Bassmaster class, six, multiple. You've won your Angler of the Years, multiple.
I like it.
Where are you going to settle down? What's that one lake that you and your family are just going to chill on?
Well, I'm not going to settle down there. I mean, we're in that state of our lives now where all of our kids are grown. They're graduated from high school. They've moved on. Our youngest just started college this year at the University of Arkansas. You know, go Hogs. And it's one of those things I would really like to spend about 3 months up north, Lake Champlain. I love Lake Champlain or the Thousand Island area. I could be very happy spending 3 months here in the Midwest, Table Rock, Grand Lake. And I know you asked for one, and then I could spend a month or two down south when it's really cold up here fishing some of the border lakes or Sam Rayburn, Toledo Bend. There's so many great lakes here in the U.S. that we don't get the opportunity to fish on a year-to-year basis, and to be able to fish those lakes when they're biting would be the ultimate dream, in my opinion.
No, I mean, there you go.
I mean, why pick one when you can pick a multitude of them?
Yeah, you can pick your friends, you can pick your lakes, but you can't pick your friends' lakes.
Dance with who brung you.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying.
That's, exactly.
There it is right there. Hey, what fisherman amazes you every time? What fisherman most impresses you on tour?
you know, there's a lot of guys that do. I mean, number one fisherman that 100% amazes me and everybody in this world is Kevin Van Dam. I mean, for the number of years that he's done it. I mean, I started 6-7 years after Van Dam, and to look at the career that he's had, the fact that Kevin never doubts a decision he makes, he amazes me day in, day out. I mean, yeah, he's had his ups and downs in this industry. I mean, he's had a year or two that's been a little tough on him, but I mean, he does amaze me. I mean, I gotta throw one out there to my buddy Jeff Crete. I mean, I've traveled with a lot of guys. I've fished with a lot of guys locally and nationally, and I really don't believe there's a person out there, a fisherman out there, that finds them and figures them out as quick as Jeff Crete does. I mean, his thought process when it comes to finding bass is unbelievable.
The squirrel always finds the nut.
He does.
The squirrel always finds the nut. Now, what he does with the nut is a different story.
he gets a little squirrely. Hey, do you relate life to bass fishing? Does every little bit of life to you relate somehow to bass fishing?
Oh, I definitely think it does. I mean, there's a lot of things in life as an everyday thing that relate. I mean, bass fishing is my life, so yeah, I have to relate it to bass fishing. But I mean, the whole fact of the matter is, I mean, what better way to spend your life than fishing for little green and brown fish, traveling across this great country that God created for us, and enjoying every day of it. I mean, there are a lot of things about fishing that I mean, I definitely relate directly to everyday life, but it is life for me. Yeah, I mean, it's like you said earlier.
And for us bass fishing freaks, you know, we talked about this earlier. We live and breathe bass fishing. We really do. I mean, it's such a part of our lives. And I mean, we can be driving down the street and we see a fence row or a rock pile, and we'll be like, damn, I wish that was underwater. You know what I mean? That happens.
It's funny you said that, because I mean, I've used that very scenario in a lot of the seminars that I do across the country. The one thing that I think makes a good angler is an angler that can visualize underwater what he is fishing. And the best way to visualize what's under the surface is when you're driving down the highway beside a creek, you're looking at those creek bends and you're looking at the shoals and you're looking at all the variety of things that creek has to offer. And you can interpret that every time you hit the water. I mean, the fence rows, the tree rows, the ditches. I mean, it all makes sense when you understand what is above water is below water as well. And it all starts coming together, and it is really cool. I mean, one of the things, and I've got to throw this out there because I talked to my brother right before we got on the show tonight. And one of the biggest things that my brother and I always used to say, we grew up fishing team tournaments together. And I mean, to really be good at fishing a jig or a bait on the bottom is, we always used to tell ourselves, you got to be the bait. And I know that sounds funny.
Be the ball. Be the ball,
Danny. You got to be the ball. I mean, that's what it comes down to. And when you can visualize what that jig is actually doing as it's crawling through the rocks or up and down over stumps or whatever it's doing, and you're actually feeling what it's doing, it makes all the difference in the world. Be the bait. That's all I can say.
Nice. You're zenning it.
You can say that.
Hey, you got some great things going on, man. I mean, and congratulations on picking up Cabela's as a major sponsor in the past couple of years.
You know, it's been unbelievable to work with the Cabela's people, and there's going to be a lot of cool stuff coming this year. I'm not going to let the cat out of the bag.
Oh, come on.
But, I mean, whole Cabela's team, it's going to be a whole new look for all of us. I mean, it's going to be a little bit of a shock and awe kind of a deal. I mean, everybody has seen the Cabela's team as this for the last 4, 5, or 6 years. And it's going to be a little eye-opener this year when we all show up to the first event. The opportunity to work with Cabela's and Big Bite and D&J Plastics and the companies I'm working with, Sunline, to do the Signature Series products that I have in the Cabela's stores now, has been phenomenal. And the whole Cabela's marketing and buying team, they're just an absolute joy to work with, you know. And then you look at the other side of the industry and what might be going on if everything goes through. I mean, you know, with Johnny Morris owning the White River Marine Group, I mean, you know, I'm a Stratus sponsored angler, but the truth of the matter is, I mean, Johnny owns Stratus, Triton, Ranger, and you know, we're anglers now that are supporting that whole, I guess, brotherhood of boat companies. And I mean, that's really what's cool about this industry is you can do a lot of things for a lot of different people, and everybody's going to see benefit from it some way down the road.
Nice. Excellent. Hey, any final words, Mike, for your fans out there, or our viewers?
You know, man, just be sure and, you know, look me up on, I've got all those social media accounts, and I'm not going to claim to be the one that runs them all because my wife does a phenomenal job. But I mean, you know, definitely follow me on Instagram and Twitter, and then check out my Facebook. My website is fairly updated. I mean, websites are almost a thing of the past, I think, but, you know, we all have to have one. But, you know, the thing about it is I've had a tremendous fan support and following over the years. Family has been unbelievable. I would not be where I'm at without the support of my whole family. Everybody from my mom, dad, aunts, uncles, brothers, you know, sons, everybody has contributed to what I'm able to do today. And if it wasn't for everybody's cooperation, I mean, I wouldn't be near as successful as I've been. And I just thank the good Lord that I'm able to chase little green brownfish around the United States and make a living doing it.
It's awesome, dude. Awesome. And thanks so much for coming on the show and showing your support for being here and on the social media and all that good stuff. We're trying to grow this from a seed to a tree, buddy.
Let's get it cranking, man. This has been an awesome deal. I watched a couple episodes before we did the show tonight. I mean, Overstreet said it earlier. This show has got awesome potential. I mean, when I looked at the lineup of people you've had on the show in the last 60 or 90 days, it's unbelievable. I mean, you look at the Greg Hackneys and you know, Davey Hyde and Chad Pipkins and Jerry McInnes and all the people you've had on the show. It's an incredible lineup of people. And we're going to grow this thing into something big. We're going to keep helping you and just keep getting it out there on social media, and it'll happen.
Awesome. Thanks.
Thank you.
It's crazy that that you kind of guys want to come on with a bunch of knuckleheads like us, you know?
What better do we have to do this time of the year but kick back at our house, enjoy a little time off, and be on cartoon television?
And you know what? Hackney was on at that Texoma event that you were talking about early. He ended up winning it.
Yeah.
And we're good luck for you guys.
We're really good luck. Yeah, people win after coming on this show. So just know that it's coming in the next tournament you fish.
Overstreet didn't even think we fished.
Yeah, he's like, oh, there's a hippie, a bearded lumberjack, and a cat lover.
He thought we were like that guy on the 1000 over there.
Yeah.
That doesn't fish, you know?
But anyway, first day of the Derby. Hackney comes on the show, calls in. I'm like, are you sure you want to do this, Greg? It's the first day of the big event, man. He's like, hey, nothing, dude. Just first day. Just first day, dude.
That's Hackney, man. That's, I mean, Hackney is
that's a good impersonation.
The breed of his own. That's all you can say about Hackney.
This is awful. Hey, thank you again so much. Mike McClelland on the Instagram, on the Twitter, on the book vase. Watch him on Bass University and the 2017 Elites and MLF Tour. Boom, right there. Thank you so much, man.
Thanks, Mike.
Peace to you.
Thank y'all for having me on. We'll see you. Peace out.
Happy holidays.
Thanks, Mike McClellan.
Hey, Stray Cast Outdoor Cartoon Television. I'm Pat Renwick. Who are you?
I'm Ryan Popcorn Whitaker.
That's right.
I just said my...
Why'd I do popcorn? And this guy right here.
Ryan Whitaker.
I'm JP Kitty.
He's the JP Kitty.
He don't give a damn.
He's nope. Just a dude. Hey, next week we have Brian the Carpenter from Mike Live coming on. Brian the Carpenter from Mike Live and Boyd Duckett. If you can't duck it, turn into next week's show. Right there. Hey, Stray Cast Outdoor Cartoon Television, thank you all for tuning in. Thank you for your support. Don't forget, StrayCast.net, StrayCast Bookface, StrayCast Instagram, StrayCast Twitter, and...
iTunes.
There it is. Catch you next week.
Vitamin water.
Vitamin water. God bless you all. Peace. We'll be right back.
Fish it out.